When Claire stumbles upon this dead Highlander, she thinks of all the men she's seen killed in war. The rebellion is here, and though she hopes they can change the outcome, she fears they will not.
The Jets are gonna have their day tonight. The Sharks are gonna have their way tonight.
Jamie wishes he was staring at a dead guy. Instead, he's witnessing Murray and O'Sullivan arguing over whether to fight now or wait. Jamie tries to be the voice of reason, pointing out there's a huge bog between them and the British. And it's no surprise that Prince Charlie isn't much help.
Territory folks should stick together. Territory folks should all be pals.
Pals to the left of me, jokers to the right.
Why must the Scots be such intractable people?
Oh, please. Look in the mirror, Chuck. Then he says Claire should care for the British wounded first, since they're also his father's subjects. Jamie doesn't think the men will like that, or that Claire will follow such an order. Charles says she would for her lord and master. Yeah, right.
You don't know her like I do.
Boredom has set in, and Angus passes the time by bedeviling the new guys. Kincaid is not amused.
So go away.
Rupert gives them grief about their ideas of battle, but Ross says they'll do what needs doing. Good old Angus taunts they'll turn tail at the first cannon fire.
Them spiked words, oh laddie, don't you see? You cannot say those words to me. Take it back, what you said just then. Lower point of our fist, and we'll go again.
Yikes!
Honey, don't.
Thank goodness Jamie arrives and stops potential bloodshed. After things calm down, he asks Dougal for a private word. Jamie says someone needs to check out that swamp land between them and the British camp. Boy, is he good. It only takes a few well-placed words, and Dougal is volunteering to be that guy.
Hook, line, and sinker.
You've got to admit it. Dougal definitely has a dramatic flair. Now, where have I seen that before? Oh, yeah!
Oh, we can be heroes, just for one day.
I'm really not sure who's more amazed by Dougal. The Scots, the British soldiers, or Prince Charles.
When you're extraordinary, you got to do extraordinary things.
I can say Angus is tickled to meet the prince, and proud to claim Dougal as his personal buddy.
He's my friend, and he'll stay my friend. Doesn't matter what the other people say.
Just as Jamie predicted, Dougal finds the land too boggy to cross, but not before a few near misses.
Too close for comfort.
When Johnny comes marching home again, hooray, hooray. We'll give him a hearty welcome then, hooray, hooray.
The good news is that his efforts brings him the long-coveted recognition from the prince. The bad news is now they have to find another way to get to the Redcoats. But at least Dougal has kept a sense of humor.
And now, I'm off to change my breeks, because the hero of the hour has shat his pants.
Oh, what a guy.
I love how Claire bonds with other women. First the wool walkers, then at Lallybroch, and in Paris. Now she's bringing these women together to form their own medical team to treat the wounded after battle.
This one's for the girls who love without holding back.
Fergus brings a local man to Claire, who says he knows a hidden trail that will let the Highlanders sneak past the bog and surprise the English. She takes him to Jamie and the prince, and they decide to act on the information right away.
That this could be the start of something big.
They may be the newbies, but Ross and Kincaid are terribly practical. They agree if one of them falls in battle, the other would take care of his buddy's family.
I don't care where I'm going, just as long as I'm with you. Put it there, pal. Put it there.
This whole thing intrigues Angus, and he decides to discuss it with Rupert.
One day you'll look to to see I've gone.
He says he'll give him his sword, dirk, sporran, and Scarlet, the part-time whore. Everything.
Baby, you can drive my car.
Rupert thinks Angus is jinxing them and is appalled at the idea. Murtaugh and Jamie also become philosophical and contemplate what it would take for their deaths to have any meaning. They both feel weighed down by their failure to stop this in Paris, and knowing they feel the same way is their only solace.
For united we stand, divided we fall, and if our back should ever be against the wall, we'll be together, together, you and I.
Anticipation.
Fergus begs to be allowed to go along and fight. He isn't happy to be told he needs to stay and see to the safety of Claire.
'Cause all I wanna do is have some fun.
Angus guilts Claire into a kiss goodbye, while Rupert insists there's no need to say goodbye because no one's gonna die. Murtaugh assures Claire he'll watch over Jamie, and she assures him history says they will win the day at Prestonpans.
If we get through this, no, we can get through anything.
And then the hardest farewell.
So kiss me and smile for me. Tell me that you'll wait for me. Hold me like you'll never let me go.
On your way, soldier.
I don't know when I'll be back again.
As the men follow their guide on the hidden path, Claire tells the women they should rest while they can. Then she realizes Fergus is missing.
Here was a kid with his hat down high. He was zero the hero in no time back.
Oh, he doesn't look well. But give him credit, when he's told to stay out of harm's way, Prince Charles says he's ready to lead the army into battle. Jamie reminds him the rebellion wouldn't survive his death, and regaining the throne wouldn't mean as much to King James without his son. Then Charles says something that almost makes me feel sorry for him.
Mark me. I don't believe my father is all that fond of me.
And the cat's in the cradle and the silver spoon.
Meanwhile, the women continue the preparations for the wounded.
Bandages, bandages, bandages.
Claire understands their nerves and gives them the same kind of rousing speech that Jamie gave to the men last episode.
We can afford to be innocent. Stand up and face the enemy. It's a do or die situation. We will be invincible.
It's my
blood on your face, a big disgrace, waving your banner all over the place.
We will rock you.
Sing it!
We will rock you.
Are you ready? Hey, are you ready for this? Are you hanging on the edge of your seat? Out of the doorway, the bullets rip. To the sound of the beat, yeah. Another one bites the dust. Another one bites the dust. And another one gone. And another one done. Another one bites the dust. Hey, hey, we're gonna get you too. Another one bites the dust.
The women are already busy with the wounded when Ross arrives carrying Kincaid. But there's nothing Claire can do.
No rest time. On your work on
injured British prisoners arrive just as Angus brings in a severely wounded Rupert. Claire works to save him, while we get to see how Angus kept Rupert from being killed outright.
You can't escape my private eyes. They're watching you. They see your every move. Private eyes. They're watching you. Private eyes. They're watching you, watching you, watching you, watching you.
Claire looks over Angus and thinks he might have a concussion. She tells him he can stay, but to not fall asleep.
I'll be keeping both eyes on his big belly. Going up and down.
As long as it does. There's hope.
Hey.
Finally, some good news.
We are the champions, my friend.
Fergus is also physically safe, but he's in shock from killing an English soldier. Claire is appalled and offers what comfort she can.
Ooh, child, things are gonna get easier. Ooh, child, things will get brighter.
I can't tell if Dougal is putting mortally wounded men out of their misery or murdering them. He finds Lieutenant Foster, a.k.a. Lieutenant Cutie Pie from Season 1. Dougal even acknowledges him to be the only honorable redcoat in Lord Thomas's staff, yet he kills him outright. Now I know. As Angus watches over Rupert, Ross is finally saying goodbye to Kincaid. And he tells Angus he was wrong.
We did not run.
You did not desert me, my brothers and I.
The guys lighten the mood by joking that Rupert's weight probably saved him. But I want to point out that he was always standing next to skinny Angus. And besides, everyone knows the camera adds 15 pounds. Anyway, Claire sees a hoof print on Jamie's back and wants to make sure there's no blood in his urine. This leads to a playful bet with the English to see if Jamie can hit the mark, so to speak.
Eye on the target and wham! One shot, one gunshot, and bam!
Buzzkill! Prince Charles thanks Claire, then says he's glad for the victory, but not that it was over Englishmen. They're really all one country. Man, let's build a campfire and join hands.
Kumbaya, Lord, kumbaya.
It's all the more shocking when an exuberant Dougal bursts in and, not seeing the prince, starts demanding they kill all the surviving British. Jamie tries to shut him up, but Charles is appalled and orders Dougal to be kicked out of his army. Jamie argues that Dougal is a warrior and that the prince needs every man. He suggests Dougal take a group of men to scout and harass the British instead, and Charles agrees. Dougal says he owes Jamie big time, then uses the 1740s version of, I see what you did there.
You champion me, and you exile me, both at the same time. That's a plan worthy of my brother Colum.
There's a sneaky little side of me.
Season 2 has been full of interesting twists and changes, but now we see the most devastating one. Remember that cannon blast that sent Angus flying? It caused severe internal bleeding and, well...
When I find myself in times of trouble, Mother Mary comes to me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be. And in my hour of darkness, she is standing right in front of me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be.
There will be an answer, let it be.
For most, it's a time of celebration, but Jamie says war tastes bitter no matter the outcome. They realize the fact that Claire was right about Prestonpans means she's also right about Culloden. Rupert and Ross, in what is time-honored tradition, mark their grief in drink and song.
Come, let us drink while we have breath, for there's no drinking after death. Down, down, down among the dead men, let him lie.
And in the end, the love you take